I cannot tell you how honored I am to be here, ladies. I know quite a few of you. I see some names I know, which is always really, really lovely. Like Sharon said, it has been a while. But this evening, we're talking about a couple of things. We're going to look at and understand that you've been doing something about like the different sephiras. So what I thought we could do is look at the sephira of the week that's coming up, the week we've got, which is sort of Malchus, and also tie that a little bit into the book of Ruth. Now, Ruth is a huge, it's a very short, even safer, but there's a lot of it, a lot to talk about. We're not going to get through the whole thing. It's not going to be comprehensive, because if it was, it wouldn't be Torah. The point of Torah is there's always more to do. But we're going to look, try and see a little bit of something we can take away. I like to have a bit of a takeaway when we're working to talking together. So let's look a little bit now. Sharon, are you there? How's this pace? Sharon is my pacemaker, in the sense that if it gets too fast, she's going to wave at me and tell me to slow down. So you're ready for that one, Sharon. I have to say it's really very hard on Zoom because I'm used to lots of interruptions. You don't get to be, you know, blown her a busy mummy and teach teenagers without and get to actually finish a sentence. So if you want to interrupt, I'm not sure how we can do that on Zoom, but you know, you can have a try. So let's talk a little bit about Malchus, just a little bit as an introduction.
Can I just ask you a funny question? Can you see if anybody writes in the chat? Because I don't know what.
Well, that's actually a really good idea. I don't know if I can. I told you I'm not very technological.
But I'm going to just try that.
So if something comes up in the chat, then we can.
I'm going to put it to everyone. Hi, Aidel. See if you can see this. Because if it is in somebody, then we can put it in
chat. Tucker. Yeah, it comes up. So that's a really good idea. So if you want to join in, just pop it in that chat. And then if there's anyone's on the phone, I'm not sure how they would do that if they're calling in, but we'll work it out. Okay, so you have a question, pop it in the chat. And when I get to a place to pause, I will try and address it. The good thing about the chat is if I don't know the answer, I can pretend I haven't seen it. So that's really helpful. Okay, so Malchus, again, when we look at Malchus, right, it means a king. Like how many, put your hand if you think you are a king. Forget, please, the British royal family. That is not what we're not talking about royal families these days. When the Torah talks about the concept of a melech, of a king, it's the one who directs everything. It's the one who is a conduit, a channel for all the good Hashem wants to give us. How does this king do that? First of all, they're a role model. Second of all, they're the one who makes everything that could happen happen. That's the point of a leader. Lots of things could happen. If you think about a general in an army, they've got loads of things that could happen. They could go left, they could go right. They're the one who puts it into practice and reality and shows how it comes together. So I don't know if you've been doing this, but some people have a kind of a chart of the different sephiras, right? I don't know if you've seen that. It sort of divides itself up a little bit. If you, there's some on the left, some on the right, they join together. Malchus, the I don't have a translation. It's kind of called kingship, rulership, but there's not really the same thing. Malchus is right at the bottom. If it was a tree, it would be the tree trunk. The bit that puts it all together, makes it grow, and makes it real. So Malchus that we're going to look at today is about putting all the other stuff we've done and learned about and all our theories. Oh, thank you very much. Right, there's our pretty chart, right? See that black splodge on the bottom? That's Malchus. Okay, so it's about putting everything we've done so far into action, bringing it into reality. And we're going to, I'd like to bear that in mind when we look at why on earth do we read the book of Ruth on Shavuos? More to the point, what is it even doing in Tanakh? You might not have thought of that. I didn't think of that till I read a concept from Rabbi Yisrael Miller. I'm going to bring a lot of his stuff in today. So here we go. So the book of Ruth kind of shouldn't be there. Why not? Because it's the only book we've got in Tanakh that only just tells the story of one person or one family, and that's it. There's no prophecies in there. There's no impact. There's not everybody does everything. Even say the book of Esther, Megillas Esther, it's about one or two people, but it's also about all the Jewish people, right? You have books of prophecy, Yaina, Yirmiyahu, they're prophecies as well. But this is basically the story of one, well, a couple of women, a little family and their stuff. Why are we, what is it doing in there in the first place? And why are we reading it on Shavuos? There's a couple of answers that we're given. The quick and easy one is the one that Chazal give first, the rabbis give first, that it's giving us the lineage of David HaMelech, of King David. Why do we need to know that? Because there was a kind of a discussion, a debate about whether his sort of, we'd call it Yechus these days, his lineage was okay. There was a halachic question about Rus, who was his ancestor. So the book of Rus was written by the prophet Shmuel to prove that all these rumors about David HaMelech were unfounded, and he is a valid king of the Jewish people and therefore a valid ancestor of Mashiach. Except that it doesn't need a whole book to tell you that. We could have managed with the last five pesukim. We could have just shortened the whole of davening on Shavuos, and by then everyone's really tired. We could have gone home half an hour earlier. Why do we need the whole thing in there? Shavuos is the yahrzeit of David HaMelech and his birthday as well, but we shouldn't have to. Why do we need the whole thing in there? Let me give you two other possibilities, okay? First one is, and we're going to put the Be'ezrus Hashem, put them together. First one is like this. Every yontif, I know if you've been with me before, we discussed a lot of times, every yontif's got an energy. It's not just an anniversary, right? Rabbi Dov, years back, gave me a beautiful mashal, which I use a lot. It's like an electric current, right? You have electricity running around your house. This happens in my house. Someone goes, the hairdryer's broken. Panic, right? You try living in a house with girls and the hairdryer's broken. Really, really panic. The hairdryer's broken. What's happened to the hairdryer? It's not broken. We just didn't plug it in. Okay, so you need to plug things in order for them to work. How do we plug in to the a spiritual energy? We are spiritual, but we're in a body. How do we do that? Torah understands, Hashem understands that we're physical human beings. So we use our senses. So Pesach, we use our sense of taste. We eat our matzah, we eat our maror, and that helps us plug into the spiritual energy of Pesach, of freedom and renewal. Hanukkah, you see the lights of the menorah and it helps you plug in to the inspiration, to the inspiration in a dark time. See how that works? Goes even deeper. Sometimes we have to actually reenact what happened, not just because it's anniversary, but by acting what everybody did at the time, we kind of plug into the whatever we're supposed to be doing now. So again, Sukkot, we live in a temporary dwelling. Pesach, we eat what they ate then. But Shavuos is a toughie. And the reason it's a toughie is because Rav Hirsch says, Torah, how can you have a sense, a physical sensory thing for Torah? Torah's spiritual. I mean, yeah, we eat cheesecake, right? But that doesn't really symbolize Torah, thank you. It doesn't symbolize Torah. How on earth are we going to react it? Rav Mimler says, you know what we should do? I mean, he gives us an American example. I'm going to translate. I'm here in Manchester, right? What we should do is the day before Shavuos, right? We'll charter a coach, right? This is post-lockdown. We will all drive, what is an hour and a half to the Lake District. We'll stand at the bottom of Helvellyn and we will accept the Torah like they accepted the Torah at the bottom of Parsinai. But we don't do that. So how are we gonna relive, plug into that concept of taking this beautiful spiritual Torah and making it into something real? One of the things we can do is look at the journey of a real person who did that. It's hard for us because we were born, or we have already now, at some point accepted the Torah. For a long, long time, we've been doing the mitzvahs. To accept from nowhere is really hard. When we look at Ruth, we look at the book of Ruth, and we see a journey of somebody who went from, starts off in something called the Sedei Moav, the fields of Moav. Think about a field, it's open, right? It's nice and free and there's no boundaries, but it's also not so safe because, you know, you could get eaten by whatever animals they have wandering around in Moab. How's my chin, Joandra? Need me to move my camera again? We good? Okay. So, you made me all subconscious now. Okay.
No, you're looking beautiful. Don't worry.
Oh, lovely. Thank you. Okay. So here we are. They're in the fields of Moab, nice wide open space. She moves from the fields of Moab to a town in Eretz Israel called Beit Lechem. Bethlehem is the English, but Beit Lechem is a place, but also has in the word bayis, which is a house. So she's going from a field to a house, which is more enclosed, more safe, more structured. And she doesn't stop there. She ends up called the Aim Shel Malchus, the mother of Malchus. We call it the Queen Mother. She's there. She's the ancestor of David HaMelech. She's there when Shlomo HaMelech, who was like the epitome of sort of Jewish empire, if there ever was one, the guy who built the Beis HaMikdash, she's there when he's on the throne. She's kind of in the throne room with him. So she's gone a huge, big journey. And if we follow at least the beginning of that journey, we can have a bit of a feel of what do we need to do to go that same journey. You with me? Chazal also say, they point out that the Torah is called a Torah's Chesed. Right. We're going to maybe, as we've got time, we'll look at what it means to have a Torah's Chesed. But it's a Torah of Chesed. What's a Torah of Chesed? The Torah starts and ends with something called Chesed. I'm carefully not translating it. I don't have a good enough translation for all these words. You probably did it when you looked at your middos, but I'm going to leave it for now. Starts with Chesed. The first Chesed in the Torah is Adam HaRishon has done a Avera. He's done something wrong. And Hashem gives him clothes. He gives him clothes, even though he's just gone and broken the only mitzvah he had. Now, Hashem is not going to get anything back out of this. Hashem doesn't need clothes. Adam can't really give him anything. He gives him a gift that is never going to be given back. Not only is it not going to give him back, but Adam's just going to have done something wrong. But he still gives him a gift. That's the beginning of the Torah. At the end of the Torah, Moshe Rabbeinu dies and Hashem himself buries Moshe Rabbeinu. What does that tell us? Again, being, you know, if you have the zechus of being part of a Chevra Kadisha, that's the ultimate in this chesed, this giving, because you don't get anything back. There's no benefit from it. So again, we've got this beginning and end of chesed. Chazal say, everyone says, oh yeah, but it's a very strange chazal. Chazal say that we read the book of Ruth because it's also got chesed. But the problem with the book of Ruth is it does end with chesed, we'll get to that, but the beginning is frankly really very embarrassing. There's a minimum amount of chesed from Klal Yisrael. In fact, there's a lack of chesed, the opposite in a lot of places. But there's something we're going to have to look at about this journey that Ruth took and where this sort of Torah of chesed comes into it all that Be'ezras Hashem we're going to try and pull together. How are we doing for pace, Sharon? Are we good? That's a novelty, isn't it? Wow, okay. Right, okay, so here we go. Let's start. I'm working, ladies, on an assumption that we've got a sort of a knowledge of the story of Ruth. But if I would say something that's not familiar, can you kind of wave at me or, I don't know, do we have hands, chats, whatever, something like that? Do something so I know that you're a bit stuck. Okay. A story starts with a famine in the land of Israel. And a king and a man called Eli Melech. Now you notice his name, Eli Melech, right? That name Malchus again, Melech, Eli Melech. He was supposed to be the leader. He was the leader. He was not only was he wealthy, he was also a leader in stature, in learning, and everything else. So he is supposed to be the one who's showing the way. And there is a famine. Now we have a very strong judgment. There's a famine in Eretz Yisrael. When there's no food, there's also a spiritual emptiness. Famines don't happen by themselves. There's something lacking spiritually. There's a lack of inner growth. Now, you might want to say, well, actually, we know from other places in the Chumash, it's fine if you are allowed to leave the land of Israel if there's no food. What is it he did so wrong? Because we know it's not so great what happens to him. Well, a couple of things he did wrong. First of all, there's actual rules, there's halachas about when you can leave if there's a famine. And one of them is, if there is food, even if it's expensive, you have to stay. You can't say I'm going because the price of food's gone up. The other bit is that if there is food now and you're just worried that it's going to run out, that doesn't count either. Eli Melech looked around, so the commentaries, he looked and he saw his people, the ones he's supposed to be leading. He felt they weren't going to do teshuva fast enough. They weren't going to repent fast enough. He didn't believe in his people. He didn't really believe that Hashem was going to have mercy several years running and hang on and hang on. And he thought, look, there might be just about enough now, but next year, they're going to be driving me mad. They're going to be asking me the whole time to give to them, and I can't. I can't give them to them spiritually. I can't teach them enough. I can't get them back on the straight and narrow. And therefore he went. He thought it was going to be temporary. He would just get out of the way until something would shock them into doing teshuva, doing what they had to do, growing inside so the food would grow on the outside. And as we know, it didn't work. And Hashem says something. Hashem says, okay, you want it that way, Eli Melech? You want to do this on the very strict, you know, Gevurah, if you've covered that idea, the Gevurah, and that's fine. You want that? That's how I'm going to treat you. So he leaves and he dies. His sons marry Moabite girls. They die. I'm just skimming about, you know, half a chapter over here, but never mind, right? His sons marry Moabite girls, and they die too, okay? And then we have a very, very famous bit in Tanakh. I want to make sure I read this, right? There's a very ending that we don't just read some. So Noemi, his wife, and again, in the Pesukim, it's only a couple of verses, but it probably spans, you know, 10 years, 15 years, I'm not sure what, spends quite a lot of time. Noemi tries to convince her daughters-in-law to go back. One goes back, Orpah goes back, and Ruth stays. And then we get, I love this, I'm going to read it anyway. Ruth, and Naomi says to her, go back. She says, go back. Even if, she says, if I would, Naomi says, right, I've lost my husband, I've lost my children, but even if I would get married this evening, become pregnant immediately, you'd have to wait 9 months till a baby's born. And even if it was a boy, what are you going to do? Wait another whatever it is years? Go away. She's not going to do it. And Ruth says like this. She says, I'm going to read this to you because it's just beautiful. You probably know it anyway. But Tome Ruth, Ruth says to her, Al tifkit ibi la'azvech. Don't entreat me. Don't beg me to leave you. La'shuv me'acharech, to go back from after you. Ki, because. And I think this is probably the most famous dialogue in the Bible. It might be anyway. Ki kol asher tilech yelech, wherever you go, I will go. Uva asher talini alim, where you sleep or rest, I will rest. Amech, Ami, your people are my people, but Elokayach Elokai, your God is my God, but Ashet Hamusi, Amus, where you die, I would die, Basham Akaber, There I'll be read. Kaya Sashem Li, she makes a promise for Khayasid Kyamabid Yafris Beni Yovenech, only death will divide us. And at that point, her Naomi gives in. Now, I know I said that was a dialogue. It doesn't look like a dialogue, does it? It looks like a bit of a speech. But we need to sort of fill in a little bit, because this is the bit where Rus does what we need to be doing. What is that takes Rus from the Stamav to be able to go to Beis Lechem? Well, the first thing she says is, Al Tazvi, don't ask me to leave you. Underneath this, we're getting a bit of a guide to what we're supposed to be doing. First step number one, I'm not leaving you. This is personal. In order for us to grow, ladies, we need a role model. And I don't mean reading a book, however elevating it is, about some a tzaddikus who lived 200 years ago who you can never, ever possibly expect to be anything like. She says, I'm not leaving you. What does it mean, leaving you? It means we need to find someone we can stick to, that we can call. There you are, I'm raving at you, right? Somebody who understands us, we understand. Now, some people can do this from books. Some people can read a beautiful book about somebody very holy and kind of imagine to themselves how a conversation would go with them. I'm nervous about the one. I think if I would try and do that, I would imagine that person saying, oh, yes, you know, imagine a Rebbetzen, whoever it is who I read about, would say, oh, yes, Aidel, go ahead and wear that, whatever you want. I kind of imagine that, you know, we kind of tweak things about. So having someone that we can call, I'll give you a personal example. When we were just married, we lived in Eretz Israel, and there was a very, very, very wonderful person, a couple of people across the street that we were very close with. I come back here, you know, some you lose a little bit of your polish as you go along. But even now, I will go out and I'll buy a dress. And I'll take it home and I'll ask my husband, you know, what do you think of this? And he'll go, And I'll say, well, everyone else is wearing it and it must be okay. He says, okay, that's absolutely fine. Just for a minute, imagine you would get Rebbetzin Rubin invites you for Shabbos. When we go back to Eretz Yisrael, we go visit them. Would you, I know you'd wear it here and I know it'd be fine here, but would you wear that if you were going to Rebbetzin Rubin for Shabbos? At which point it goes back to the shop, because that's what I'm looking at. Now that, you know, we need somebody who we can really have that really conversation with in a way someone understands us. So that's the first bit. First job, that personal touch of somebody. And then we've got this bit that Ruth says, okay, she says, where you go, I'll go, where you sleep, I'll sleep, all that bit. I know I said it was a dialogue, but our end, it's a bit like, you know, if someone's on the phone and you hear one in the conversation, you sit there trying to work out what the other person said, you're not going to make quite a game of it. We don't need to do that because Chazal have told us. Chazal tell us for each of these where you something that Ruth says, Naomi has given her one of the key mitzvahs of the Torah. I'm going to pause, and if you want to pause in the chat, if you had to come up with a key mitzvah of Torah, what that really is going to explain to everybody what Torah is about, I'll take you a second while I have my sip of drink. What would you put? What would you put? You can stick it in the chat. You can just think, what would you go for as a key mitzvah of Torah? Well, don't all shout at once. Right. Okay. When I normally do this one, someone goes kashra, someone says Shabbos, some, you know, the biggies. Okay. Here's what she says, right? Well, Naomi says to her, and if you see, you see how it fits in with the conversation. Naomi says we have something called the halacha of tuchum. Tuchum Shabbos means on Shabbos, you can't go past a certain point outside the city limits. And Naomi says, where you go, I will go. You see how this fits in? Right? Ruth says, sorry. Naomi says we have a halacha called yichud, which is that a man and a woman cannot be secluded in a house together. Right? So then what does Ruth says? Ruth says, where you sleep, lodge, I will lodge. Okay, see that's fitting together? She tells her there's actually 613 mitzvahs. They cover everything. Okay, so you see, it's been together, 613. And then she says the next thing. She tells her, there is no, that's your people, my people. She says, you cannot do idolatry. It's not enough to worship God. Also, no idols. And Ruth says, okay, your God is my God. Then Ruth tells her, now this is not what they say. If you ever go on a Kiruv seminar and they're trying to inspire people to become religious, they don't tell them about the death penalty. It doesn't come up in any of your big marketing things, right? But Naomi says, I want you to know there's different sorts of death penalty in the Torah depending on the severity of an action. Now, did that ever happen? No, we have a tradition. It was very, very rare for it actually to come to pass, but it's written down there. Okay, at which point Ruth says, well, you die, I will die. And not only that, says Rus, but if it would ever happen that there was a death penalty, then where those criminals, we would bury somebody, right? They'd be treated respectfully, but where they will be buried would be different. And that's why she says, I'll be buried. Now, doesn't look good on the PR side, right? This is not, like I said, it's not what you'd advertise for Yiddishkeit. But underneath that, what Rus is accepting is something really, really crucial about seeing, accepting Hashem in your life as a reality, okay? What's she looking at? She's saying like this. The halachas of tuchum are telling us that there are things we're just not going to do. There are boundaries. You can go some places, but not others. Or you can go some places on some days, but not interesting about Torah. There's very, very little, by the way, that's actually forbidden. Hardly anything. What there is when you can do it. So very, very special lady in Pittsburgh, actually, my husband comes from, and she ran the sort of the day school there. And they had all different sorts of people from all areas of Judaism. And they asked her once, if you could choose what's the first mitzvah you would teach, what would it be? And she said, I'd teach Melchik and Fleishik. Why? Because Melchik is okay, and Fleishik is okay, but there's times for everything. There's when you can do it is really important, and where and how you can do it. It's not always forbidden, but how and when and where you put your boundaries is crucial. So the first thing Nami wants us to know is there's going to be a boundary. There's times when things are okay and times when you're just going to have to wait. There's times when, you know, you can go outside the Tchum, you have to wait till after Shabbos, right? Next one, Yechad, this prohibition. Next thing she wants us to know is, let's face it, most of the time, so there's Yechad, this man and woman could be in a room together, in a locked room, and nothing is going to happen. Why are we getting so worried? Because something might happen. Nami says to us, this mitzvah is important because we have to understand if something's important enough, you'll put a safeguard in place. If Torah is important enough, you'll do whatever it takes to put something in place. You know, many, many years back, this is showing my age now, there was a worry. I think it was Perrier water. Do you remember? Perrier water was, they thought there might possibly be something that was carcinogenic if a rat had it in multiple quantities, right? Now, I'm not a rat, right? And it went off the shelf. That was it. It was a chance of a chance of a chance, but they weren't going to risk it. This mitzvah, Nami says, is if you care enough about something, you'll take precautions, you'll worry about it, it'll be important enough to you. She says, how important enough is this to you? Okay, that's the second one. Third one, I'm not going to go through some details, I want to show you where it's going, okay, because they're very, pretty similar. Okay, again, the fact there's 613 mitzvahs, what does that tell us? Says Ramila, it's very interesting, you know, Viktor Frankl, who was a psychologist who was in the camp, he talks about living a life of meaning. And one of the things he says is you can't have half a meaningful life. Either life is meaningful or it's not meaningful. By us, if life is meaningful, you're going to have mitzvahs that cover Torah covers every area of life. We don't just sort of turn up in shul on Shabbos and that's it. There's mitzvahs for everything. The advantage of that, by the way, is whatever your dodgy side is, whatever your bad side is, whatever not bad side, whatever your faults are, there's always something you can be good at. There's always a mitzvah that you can be good at, okay? Some people it's going to be the kind, the chesed, some people it's going to be tzedakah, some people it's going to be making an internal connection with God, whatever it is, everyone's got something they could possibly be good at, okay? And not only that, but it's unthinkable that you wouldn't have an area of life where Hashem is. Because if Hashem loves you and you love Hashem, he's going to be everywhere. Okay, I want to whip through these, ladies, so you get the idea. But all of these, okay, idolatry, even the capital punishment and burying is saying what you do is important. Your spiritual growth, and that's that Ruth's thing. Your spiritual growth is important. If it's not important, if it doesn't matter what you do, then it's not going to have an effect on everyone. I think Ruchalak talks about, you know, if you would imagine, this is like more than science, I'm not good at science, but if you would map what we think of as universe on the Albert Hall, let's see a big map of the universe, the Albert Hall. So planet Earth would be a very small speck of dust under seat number 35B, okay? And us on planet Earth wouldn't even be visible. Now, if you think you don't matter, thinking about the size of the universe is really very scary. But if you know you do matter, if you know that every action that we take can have huge ramifications, then the bigger the universe, the better, right? Because then we've got, you know, we're even greater people. That's where this whole capital punishment where you're buried comes in. What Nami is saying to us is all these boundaries, all these things you're doing is because you are so important that your actions have meaning. Now, that might be very scary, but on the other hand, it can be really enlightening and inspiring because all of a sudden we are somebody. Every single person, we'll come back to this, every single person is somebody. And Ruth says, okay, I'm going to buy that too. Here's what's fascinating. You know what she said? Nami said to her, where that you can't go here. She didn't say, okay, I won't go there. Nami said to her, you know, you can't live there. She didn't say, okay, I won't. What she said is, I will do that. You know, Pesach, my daughter went to a shir by Rabbi Hibbert, and he shares something that she said to me, and I just love this, I want to share it with you. The Hebrew word for freedom is chayrus, right? If you, which means you spell it chet yod resh vav sa, if you split up the word chayrus, you get chay rus, which means the life of rus. Okay, what is it from the life of rus that gives us freedom? All of these, no, you can't this and no, you can't that, she took and she switched round to make it something positive. So it wasn't you can't go here and you can't go there. It was, well, I will go here and I will go there because all these things that look like boundaries are there so we can do more, so we can grow more, so we can appreciate more what we've got, so we can live more fully in the world. And recognizing that is Russ's beginning. When we say, you know, we said we're going to look at what Russ did. Russ accepting that what looks like a boundary is actually an opportunity for positive growth. It's an opportunity to do something. Because if I can't go here, if I can't go over there, that means that where I am here must be really, really special. If I can't, I don't know, if I can't do this, then that what, if, let's take Shabbos, right? If I cannot go out of the Tachum on Shabbos, that first one, that means that I have to make where I am really, really special. And I can't go distracting myself with other stuff because where I am is important. If all of these things are working around that. If I'm not worshiping other gods, that I can't pass the buck, that means my relationship with Hashem is really special to Hashem. Otherwise, he wouldn't have said that. But it's so important to Hashem, my relationship with him, that we're not going to go worshipping idols. You with me, ladies, so far? Because I'm going to move slightly on that. Okay, so I'm going to pause for a second. Are we good so far? Yeah, okay, right. Okay, let's move on. Okay, so that's our first bit, that accepting that everything has got meaning. There's a space for everyone to find an area of growth, and that those, and even the no's are actually a place to make what the yeses are even more special. Okay. So they go back to Eretz Yisrael, and this is a bit, I said it was a bit embarrassing, because they get back, and you might know this bit, Nami says to everyone, don't call me Nami, which means pleasant, call me bitter. She tells them she had a terrible life, and they all say exactly nothing, right? This is absolute silence in the pasuk. It's the time of the barley harvest. Nami and Rus go and stay wherever they stay, in Beit Lechem, and nothing happens. Right? What happens these days? Someone moves in a Jewish neighborhood. Right? Everyone's bringing, they're bringing them cake and they're bringing them kugel and they're calling their friend. Nothing. God is nada. Niente zilt. It is absolutely silent. Nobody says a thing. And the commentaries wonder about that because it's not a very Jewish way to be. They give a couple of possibilities, none of which are, you know, particularly impressive. One of them is the first harvest ever. So the pasuk says it's the barley harvest, the first harvest. And they're amazed. Oh my gosh, we've finally got food back. They're so busy with that, they can't do anything else. That's the first bit. Possibly, the commentaries, it's because, you know, we said there's a concept in Halacha that a Mayavi, somebody from the nationality of Mayav, cannot become Jewish. There was a controversy about a Mayaviya, a female Moabite. The Halacha is that a Moabite, Tess, that's such a bad word, a Moabiyah, a lady Moabite, can become Jewish. But not everybody knew that halacha, so they were a bit kind of, what are you doing here, kind of thing, right? It could be that. It could also be, say some of the Farshim, that Naomi didn't ask them. She didn't want to go begging and asking and embarrassing herself. So because she didn't want to go asking of her charity, therefore it didn't occur to them that she really didn't have any money left, okay, which is a nice way of putting it. But either way, they're there in a strange land, and they are absolutely stuck. And after a little while, Naomi and Ruth have a conversation about going to take advantage of the halachas of gleaning. Okay, these are agricultural halachas, right? About if somebody's, you know, harvesting their field and they drop some bits, you know, they can pick, you know, it doesn't belong to them anymore. It belongs to the poor people who will go after them and pick up all the bits, right? If there's a corner of the certain corner of the field that has to be left for the poor people. And if you forget a bit, let's say you're picking everything up and you forget to do a bit, you can't get back for it, that's left to the poor. And they take advantage of this halacha, and Rus, who used to be a princess, is going to go off into the field. And this is where I want to talk to you a little bit about the Jewish idea of chesed, okay? Chesed is not mercy and it is not charity. It is not, I am so great and I have all this money and I am going to be so nice and give to you down there some money of mine. Here is my money and I'm giving it to you. It's not like that. Here is my time. It's not like that. Jewish idea is the pasuk when in the Torah that talks about all these mitzvahs of, you know, the corner and the forgotten grains, all the rest of it, says this belongs to the widows, the orphans, the poor, the stranger. I mean, it wasn't it wasn't the farmer's to start with. It happens to be in his field, but it's not his. It belongs to them. They're not coming snoring and asking for a favor, they are coming to get what's theirs in the first place. And you see what that does, ladies? That's really special, because what it's doing is it's giving a value even to people who don't have a lot. And that same thing works, by the way, in terms of learning and teaching. You could have somebody who's not very learned and somebody who is learned. The person who has the information is not doing this huge big favor. They're just giving him, you know, when someone's teaching, it's not like they're doing you a big favor. I mean, they are, but it's not, they don't have to condescend, because the person who's learning, it was their inheritance anyway. So it belongs to everybody. So all of these, it's a concept inside that we have to understand. It's actually, it's very interesting. Rav Matthias points out that in English, when you say kind, when I'm kind to somebody, it's the same word as the same kind. Like you have like two different kinds of chocolate. I don't know, I've got chocolate on the brain. Two different kinds of chocolate is the same kind. Because chesed, that kindness, is not that I am up here and you are down there, but I see that we have something in common. We're the same kind of being, right? We've got something in common. We're extending my concept of me into a little bit outwards. We're extending that idea. So this idea, so Ruth is going out to the field and she's going to get to glean. And that, but to be honest, human nature is what it is. And that the Torah might say what it says about this belonging to the poor people, but it's quite easy for the people who are doing the farm work to start thinking that these people are, you know, schleppers and hangers on. Okay, it's quite easy to fall into that trap. Okay, it might be easy for a farm worker not to get a little bit careless, not to leave behind what they're supposed to leave behind. Okay, it might be, they might not leave quite as much of a corner. So the halacha is that the owner of a field has to come several times in the day, morning, you know, morning, noon, and evening, to check that their workers are doing the right things. They've got lots of fields. They've got to spend a lot of time walking around, making sure that these halachas are kept properly so that the poor people can get what was already designed for them. Okay, so that is this halacha. And Ruth comes and goes. The pasuk says she goes backwards and forwards. She doesn't know where she is. She has to look for landmarks, and she's going to one field after another, behaving always in a way that's very modest. Okay, so she's not hanging around and chatting with the workers. She's making sure that she's dressed carefully, even when she has to stop bending and stretching. She's doing all that stuff. And one day, the pasuk says, she happens, don't you love that word? You know what's coming next. Happens to turn up in the field of a man called Boaz, who is a distant relative of her father-in-law. Who's passed away, distant relative. His name is Boaz. Where's Boaz been until now? Well, Boaz has actually been sitting shiva. Okay, so that's why he hasn't been in his field. But he happens, here it goes again, he happens to be in his field. Okay, he happens to be in his field when Rus gets there. Why does the Torah say happens? Because he'd gone up from shiva, Boaz, and he was the head of the Sanhedrin, like the head of the basin, the head of the courts, and they just had a meeting where they'd enacted a new halacha. What had happened? The Sanhedrin had realized that the Jewish people, yes, we'd had some food. Yes, that's really great. But we hadn't quite got there yet as a Jewish people. That spiritual kind of emptiness that had caused the famine in the first place was coming back again. They hadn't quite got the hang of it. They weren't really on the road to growth. So unlike Eli Malach, who's scarpered, Boazin is based in, say, we've got to do something. And they come up with this emergency halacha, okay? Emergency, well, not halacha, emergency custom, which is like this. When they say we meet somebody from now on, okay, we're going to use Hashem's name in there. We're going to say, right, we're going to say Hashem imachem, right? Hashem be with you, right? We're going to say, and people are going to answer us, Yibarecha Hashem, may Hashem bless you. Now, all of a sudden, you say to somebody, Hashem be with you. What are you saying to them, right? So if Ari says, if you're saying to somebody, if Hashem is with you, you're giving them a value. This was something new, right? I heard this from Rabbi Shushan. It's an incredible concept. When you say God be with you, and you're actually using Hashem's name, right? If you look at the pasuk, they use the full name of Hashem. They're not kind of skating over it. Then you're giving someone a value, because you don't link someone's name with Hashem if you don't think they've got a value. Now we know, right? At the beginning of Bereshit, Hashem says we're made in God's image. But how often do we treat people like that? Not often enough. So when Boaz, who's the head of the generation, walks into his field and he's greeting his workers, who are the lowest level of society, okay? You're not a farm worker if you could be doing something better paid or, you know, with more value. They're not necessarily educated. They're not, and we know that because we've seen that, you know, they end up, you know, flirting with the women a little bit. They're not so nicely spoken. And these people who are maybe not using such nice language, not behaving so nicely, but they're Jewish people. And he goes up to them, Hashem imachem, God be with you. Miracle. Then they say, God bless you. All of a sudden, they're giving themselves the power to give blessings. Yeah, because all of a sudden they say, oh, hey, I'm a valuable person. I am valuable. I can do valuable. There's something to me. I'm not empty. I'm not a person who deserves a famine. I'm not spiritually empty. And this is incredible. It's just like a miracle that happens. Watch what happens. He says to them, Hashem imachem. They say to him, Yivarecha Hashem. And then he notices Rus. And he says to this worker, whose girl is that over there? If he'd asked them, if he'd happened to be there the day before without this Hashem Machem, what would they say? Oh, some girls, some Moabites, you know, she probably shouldn't be Jewish anyway. We don't know who she is. She's poor. She's this, she's the other. And now what do they say? The worker says, okay, that's, she came with Naomi. And he points out to us, you know, she doesn't hang around near us. She does what's proper. She acts properly. She's not influenced badly. He gives all her, you know, her whole resume of what she gets right. Just because what? Just because somebody had said to this worker, God be with you, meaning you're a valid person. All of a sudden, he can see the good in everyone else. And because he, this worker can then do that, look what happens. You had this whole, and I'm very mindful of the time, ladies, and we've got to finish in a few minutes, so I'm going to just give this as an overview. A whole bunch of other chesed happen, okay? So what happens? Boaz then notices Ruth and extends chesed to her. He makes sure she's treated properly. He says, you know, we've heard about your chesed. Well, no one said that before. She becomes a valid person. He's noticed what's great about her. She goes back to Naomi. She talks to her. They have come up with the whole scheme. And again, I will sort of skate over the end of the story because I'm mindful we've only got 2 minutes, actually. 2 minutes now. Okay. So he says to her, Boaz ends up doing the halacha. We tend not to do this these days, called yibum, right? Where if a man dies childless, so the nearest relative will marry the widow. That's seen as a chesed. It's an incredible chesed. This is Boaz. He is the head of the Sanhedrin. Right? Think of, you know, those famous rabbis that people have on the wall, you know, those pictures, right? Imagine if one of those would marry somebody who was actually, people weren't entirely sure of, you know, what her stature was. She was poor. She might not know very much, absolute beginner, this, that, and the other. That's an incredible chesed. And from all of that, can you see how this is changing? We started off the beginning of the Megillah of Rus with everything very, 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 very strict. Elimelech is despairing of everyone's future, right? He goes off and he has a very strict judgment upon him. Rus comes back. She takes on this concept of the Torah as a something where every single thing you do is meaningful. Right? Everything, even when you can't do something, it's so that what you do is even more meaningful. Everything becomes meaningful. And once everything you do is meaningful, then everything you are is meaningful. And if, okay, if you interview, and but ladies, I'm just going to say this very clearly. Now, I'm saying this to me because I come up with these brilliant ideas and then I finish talking and I say, gosh, I can't do any of that. What a hypocrite I am. So I just want to clarify that just because we've come up with these amazing ideas, I will get off there now and I'll go, gosh, Aidel, who do you think you're kidding? Little things, right? If there's 613 mitzvahs, then one of them is also meaningful. Every little thing is meaningful. And that's what Boaz tells us. He comes from his field and he says, okay, this worker over there, he might be doing this and this and this wrong, but Hashem Imachem, he's a valid person. And the little bits he does do are huge and great and massive and make a huge impact. And therefore this person can say back to you, Baruch Hashem, Hashem can bless you. Can you see, ladies, how once you've got that bit, once how you can see that any little thing anybody does can be really great, then you can see everybody as a valid person. You can see everyone as a great person. And then what happened? Then you can have Rus, who marries Boaz, and she has a child. Okay, that child is Obed. And that's when we get the lineage. We don't get it any sooner because we can't understand it any sooner. At the end of the Megillah, we get this lineage. She has the father of David HaMelech, right? David HaMelech, King David. And he is the ancestor of the ultimate Melech, the one who really brings that whole thing into potential, who is known as Mashiach. So I am going to wish you I'm never allowed to put this. When I say a Yom Tov full of growth and there's cheesecake on the table, I'm not sure what sort of growth it's going to be. It might be sort of calorie and a Yom Tov of internal spiritual growth and not waistline growth. Okay. Or you can have that too if you want. Okay. A really, really lovely Yom Tov with lots of yummy cheesecake. I did think I said to Zippy, I said I will cut it to 45 minutes. Sharon, how was that for pace? Just how was that?
A fact.
Oh, look at that. See, I'm learning as I go. Okay. Right. Next time we'll be too slow. Okay. But I did say that if you want to hang on, I've got like 10 minutes for people to just join in and whatever else and, you know, stick things in the chat or whatever. But otherwise we can call it a night and get on with our chicken soup. So if you want to disappear, that's fine. I'll hang on if you have any queries and questions and things to discuss.
Okay. Has anybody got any questions? First, that was absolutely beautiful. Thank you. Thank you. Thanks, clear, Jen. Beautiful and great. Really beautiful presentation. So if anybody does have any questions, is there anything you would like? We usually do go up to around 9:30. So feel free if there's anything you want to share with us. If anybody has any questions, please ask.
No,
and then we'll be my fresh challah here.
Oh, you're all very welcome. Okay. Now you tell me 9:30. I cut so much out. How funny.
Okay. Anybody with any question? Anything that you wanted to add, Aidel, that you took out because you felt pressured with time?
Yeah.
Can I just ask, like, maybe I haven't read it properly or understood it properly, but doesn't Naomi encourage Ruth to not adhere to Yehud with Boaz?
Whereas... That is an absolutely brilliant question. I wanted to know that too. Okay, so the answer, and I'm so glad that occurred to me before you asked it, because I had to go and find out the answer myself. Yay. Because when she goes down the threshing floor, now you didn't read it wrong. The difference is, when does the halacha take place? There's a difference in halachas. And if I get this wrong, then please forgive me, because I only just like learned it myself. So I'm hoping I'm going to get this exactly right. If there's a difference in halachas between what's called deraisa halachas and derabanan, halachas that are written in the Torah and then extra, you know, we talked about those safeguards, right? The safeguards that Rabbanan put in. The actual halachas of Yichud do not apply to people who could not technically marry each other. So, for example, a married man and a married lady cannot have Yichud together according to the Torah. In the times of Shlomo HaMelech, right, so that's Rus's descendant, the Beis Din put in an extra safeguard and said even a single man and a single woman who could technically get married and it wouldn't be a problem can also not have yichud together. So at the time this is happening, they're not contravening the halacha because this extra safeguard hadn't been in place yet. So they're not contravening any halacha from the Torah.
Perfect. Thank you so much.
All right. Well, Baruch Hashem, I asked that question 2 days ago to somebody else. So we would really start, wouldn't we?
Okay. Well, anyone else? Please.
Why were there such a lack of chesed then?
Do you know, that's a really, really good question.
Because now we can't live with the mafarshim, we just do naturally.
It is something we just naturally, and it's interesting, isn't it? Because the mafarshim wants to know that. What was it that they were so self-involved with? You know, it's a very good question. I don't have an answer. I think, you know, I'm at a guess, you know, we came up with a couple of possibilities that it could be, that it wasn't an overall lack of chesed. It might have been a... You know, it's very easy to do chesed to people, you know. It's very easy to be pleased with chesed. You know? It's very easy to answer an appeal that stirs your heartstrings. You know, it's very interesting. There's a story, I think it's from Elia and Lopian. He was in Eretz Yisrael. He saw a poor person begging and he went past and he gave him some money. And then he stopped and he went back and he gave him some more money. And his talmidim, his students were with him and they said, well, you know, what was all that about? He said, well, the first time I saw this guy, like Nebuch, right? He had sores on his legs. He had broken limbs. He was this, he was that, he was the other. I felt terrible for him. I felt really bad. So I gave him the money, but that was to make me feel better. I felt bad for him. So I gave him something to make me feel better. Then I had to go back and do the mitzvah of giving it because a poor person, because it's his money to start with. It's okay, why am I saying that? Because I think, and I'm guessing here, and I'm maybe talking to myself, it's easier to do a chesed when your heart is pulled. It's easy to do a chesed short term. You know, I cannot tell you the number of times in my life where I've offered to do something for somebody. And I thought, wow, aren't I great, right? Look at me, wonderful. I'm going to make chicken for this one and kugel for that one the first time. And then the next week they asked me again. And by the fourth week, my kids are saying, mommy, aren't you making kugel for whoever it is this week? Because she's still, you know, in bed or whatever else it happens to be. And I'm like, oh my goodness me, why did I do this? At that point, it stops being natural, and we have to have the mitzvahs to tell us to do it, otherwise we wouldn't do it. And I'm wondering, I don't know if this is going to answer, if this is the answer or an answer or no answer at all. I'm wondering if the issue here with Rus and Naomi was that they were out of sight, they weren't going to go around asking, and there was a certain kind of question about do they really hear or not, and it wasn't the easy chesed. You had to really think about it, and because Boaz is busy sitting shiva, there's really nobody to tell them, you know, you have to do it differently. That will be a guess, but I don't have a clear answer. You know, your guess is as good as mine.
I just had a thought myself, and that was because when Ruth and Naomi came back in tatters, she went like a princess, and people didn't know where to put themselves. Maybe.
Do you know, that is absolutely brilliant, because that's actually what Lipschitz says. He says, if you look at the pasuk, so there you are, Baruch Shekavanti. He says, if you look at the pasuk, Naomi comes. I'm actually going to quote it. I want to make sure I get it exactly right. When you look at the verse, Naomi comes back and they say, is this Naomi? They're kind of overwhelmed by her, right? You're absolutely right. They look at her, they're absolutely overwhelmed by her and what she looks like and what's going on. And she says to them, why are you calling Naomi when Hashem's made things bad for me? And that's such a shocking thing to hear. I mean, these days we're used to saying, oh, everything comes from Hashem. But, you know, there they were taken aback, but they didn't really have an answer for her. And the truth is, when someone is suffering, saying, oh, well, it's fine, everything comes from Hashem, is probably not the best thing to do, okay? It's very nice, you know, we say it to ourselves. You don't really say that to someone who's suffering. So they don't have an answer for her. And like you're saying, it could have actually this kind of embarrassment. And the pasuk goes straight from that, right? She says, I've come back and all these bad things have happened to me. And then it just says, and the touch of Nami Barutamaga, they come back and it's the middle of the barley harvest and you get this absolute silence, almost like they don't quite know what to do. They don't know where to put themselves, and they don't know if bringing her something is going to make it better or worse. It could be she's going to be really excruciatingly embarrassed at having to receive more chesed. Okay, it could be that she's going to find it difficult. Exactly, that is exactly what Ashley Warren Lucia says, is they don't quite know what to do with it. Is it going to make things worse or better? They're waiting for her to come to them, but she's not going to come to them.
Okay.
Thank you. The same thing really happened with Rabbi Akiva when, how the 24,000 students get it all wrong.
Yeah. It is bizarre.
It's like, it doesn't make sense, does it?
No. But we await Be'ezras Hashem Mashiach's arrival very soon to hear all the answers and to give us all that beautiful clarity that in Mitzvah Hashem we will all be zeichet to.